Good evening. I'm Lily Kober, the Vice President of the League of Women Voters of Berks County. Welcome to our monthly program. Since March is National Women's History Month, we are honoring that month and its topic with our guest, Ms. Hallie Vaughan, who is here to tell us about one of those stories of women's history that is very seldom known or has been told about. Our guest, again, is Hallie Vaughan. Ms. Vaughan, it's all yours, darling. Okay.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Lily and the League of Women Voters for inviting me here today to tell you the story of the Hello Girls. This past summer, Sally Redding from the Alvernia Seniors College said to me, Hallie, you have to read this book called The Hello Girls from World War I. And when I did, I was absolutely enthralled by it. I'm dressed today as one of the Hello Girls who were inducted into the United States Army Corps in World War I, and their job was to run the telephones, sometimes on the front lines. And they were called the Hello Girls because when they answered the phone, they said, hello, number please. And the uniform I'm wearing was very very structured, I guess.
There you go, structured.
You'd say structured. Everybody had to wear their uniform. The skirts had to be 11 inches off the floor. They could wear no makeup. They could wear no jewelry except a wedding ring if they had one. And so the Hello Girls went through a lot of scrutiny before they became soldiers. So at the outbreak of World War I, what was it like for women in the United States? No one imagined what an immense unintended effect this war would have for American women. Woodrow Wilson was president, and although he had progressive ideas, he was against giving women the right to vote. In Europe, the war had been going on for 2 years, and Wilson hovered nearly 3 years between the conviction that the European conflict could not touch the U.S., as he said in 1914, and the realization in 1917 that neutrality was no longer feasible or desirable where the peace of the world was involved. So United States neutrality ended on April 2nd, 1917, when Wilson asked Congress to, quote, formally accept the status of belligerent, which has thus been thrust upon it. And the Senate voted 82-6, and the House of Representatives voted 373-50 in his favor. On the day Congress declared America's belligerency, legislators also entertained a bill to commandeer the vital telephone system of the District of Columbia to ensure, quote, complete control of such means of communication in safeguarding its military and executive affairs, unquote. Telephones solved old problems of communication in battle. Remember Paul Revere and his lanterns, one if by land and two if by sea? Well, telephones became one of the war's most important weapons overnight and turned women into soldiers. In 1917, telephones became the central nervous system of the United States Army. For the first time, officers and troops positioned miles apart communicated easily once an operator connected them. Lightweight telephones facilitated troop operations and movements, supply orders, and moment-by-moment tactical decisions. And women, it so happened, were masters of this new technology, the only one in which Americans led during the war. As of 1900, 80% of operators were female. The telephone systems that sprang up across the country preferred women. Gender expectations trained girls from birth in the diplomacy required for conversing with inpatient callers. Women also showed great nimbleness with the multiple jacks and sockets, ringers and buzzards on the boards of busy switchboard stations. And women had few other opportunities for well-paid white-collar employment. Even some college graduates aspired for telephone work. A spinner in a clothing factory might earn $1 per day, while an operator earned $2.50 a day. And these jobs were much in demand.
Go to the picture.
Merle Egan helped relay the first transcontinental calls that took place while war blazed in Europe. She said, "I was fortunate enough to listen in on the first conversation from Washington, D.C. to the West Coast." She then worked for Mountain States Telephone and Telegraph. Born on a Kansas farm, she grew up in the coal mining camps of southern Colorado, where her father was superintendent of mines until fired for his rabble-rousing and fiery Irish temper. At the time, fewer than 15% of young Americans graduated high school, and Merle was no exception. She completed 3 years before economic circumstances sent her to work, first as a relief operator, then as a toll operator in the PBX exchange of Denver's Brown Palace Hotel. She said, "From that July day in 1906, when I became an operator in Denver, I was fascinated by the fact that people could communicate through the cords I handled." And she wrote that. She thought it was like holding lives in her palm. By the time World War I began, she was a traffic supervisor with 11 years of experience. She was also 29, unmarried, and being courted at a slow pace by a man in no hurry to make plans. She was a fit, well-proportioned 165 pounds, taller and bigger than many men. It must have been hard to be 5'11" in an era when the average male topped out at 5'6". But her employer described her as industrious, level-headed, even-tempered, and cautious, with instinctive tact in difficult situations. She was a natural leader, and her loyalty is unquestioned. On the day Congress declared war, the Washington office of the Signal Corps had exactly 11 officers and 10 men. Almost overnight, their job became to provide communications for an army of 4 million, nearly half of whom would be stationed in a foreign country, 4,000 miles away across the ocean. The Corps needed an additional 50,000 trained men to build and operate, sometimes under bombardment, a communication system more than 400 miles long with branches throughout France. Where would the Army find them? On duty in France, Captain Robert B. Owens of the Signal Corps made a bold recommendation in the fall of 1917. The problem, he said, was that most men didn't know how to speak French. They'd never seen a switchboard before sailing. He suggested that they recruit bilingual American women and give them the relative military rank corresponding to the British scheme. He became the brunt of many jokes, but as Signal Corps reports emphasized the stakes, quote, "The importance of intercommunication in warfare cannot well be exaggerated," Brigadier General George Squire wrote. "The element of time is a controlling one in strategy and tactics. Without communications for even an hour, the whole military machine would collapse." General Jack Pershing decided that he must draw from another labor pool. His November 18, 1917 cable read, quote, "On account of the great difficulty of obtaining properly qualified men. I request organization and dispatch to France a force of women telephone operators, all speaking French and English equally, unquote. There would be 3 chief operators, 9 supervising operators, 78 local and long distance operators, and 10 substitutes. And he said, all must be in uniform. All take the soldier oath. Uniforms and brass insignia conferred status. The Army had to recruit a nucleus of females ready to abandon their privacy, risk their modesty, accept military discipline, and brave submarine attack. A mailing campaign to newspapers and postmasters around the country was begun. It advertised the Army's urgent need for 100 bilingual operators for, quote, immediate service in France, unquote. They would earn the same pay as male soldiers doing the same Signal Corps work, $60 per month, 3 times the wage of naval yeoman clerks. Supervisors would earn $72 a month, and chief operators, $125. Some operators took a pay cut to serve the Army without any compensatory stipend, such as AT&T gave them. The Adjutant General of the United States, the Army's legal counsel, sent a memorandum to clarify the new recruit's status. He said, these women will be civilian employees of the Signal Corps and will have the privileges and allowances now prescribed, or which may hereafter be prescribed by Army regulations and general orders for Army nurses, unquote. But General George Squire felt that the operators were regular soldiers. Operators would handle all telephone communications and national secrets. Only uniformed soldiers under military discipline occupied such positions of extraordinary trust. So there was great controversy and confusion about women operators in the military. Quoted in newspapers across the nation, Lieutenant Ernest Wesson promised, quote, they are going to astound the people over there by the efficiency of their work. In Paris, it takes from 40 to 60 seconds to complete 1 telephone call. Our girls are equipped to handle 300 calls per hour, unquote. The Hello Girls had the operational support of General Pershing, who needed them desperately, but the War Department was scared of female soldiers. In the first weeks of December 1917, letters began pouring into the War Department, which had not yet even printed application forms. More than 7,600 women inquired about the first 100 positions. Wesson reviewed the inquiries with an AT&T team in New York, headed by R.F. Estabrook. The committee narrowed the considerations to 1,750 strong prospects from the United States and French-speaking regions of Canada. There were many different reasons for enlisting: a yen for adventure, a desire to help your family in the war, a hatred of German aggression. As one young woman described her emotions, quote, Pershing's call had aroused in me a great, unquenchable, patriotic desire to do my bit, unquote. Eventually, there were 223 American women who labored at Army switchboards in Europe, a few within sight and sound of the furious battlefield. They were an intrepid group with mixed backgrounds, united in common purpose.
Next screen.
Their torchbearer was 25-year-old Grace Banker, a bright-eyed, chestnut-haired native of New Jersey who possessed a strong sense of purpose, an extraordinary stock of energy, a sensible personality, and an open smile. Following graduation in 1915, Grace landed a job at A&T headquarters in New York, where she advanced quickly. She read the notice regarding recruits for telephone service in France in the Sunday New York Globe on December 5th, 1917. 4 days later, she wrote the chief signal officer, quote, I understand both French and English and have a thorough knowledge of telephones. Grace, unquote. Grace waited a month, then sent another letter fearing that she had been bypassed. She said, if my application has not been accepted for the present, would I be eligible for a second unit if such should be formed? Soon thereafter, the Signal Corps sent Grace a form asking for educational background, employment experience, medical history, and a formal photograph or a snapshot if it was a good likeness, unquote. Hundreds of potential recruits received the same request. Grace may have been one of those motivated by adventure, though the diary she kept, despite Army regulations, also makes plain her patriotism. She had a brother in the 77th Field Artillery. Grace may have stretched the truth about her language fluency, because another applicant in the pool considered Grace's French rusty. Next screen.
Here it is.
Louise Le Breton was a tall, headstrong student at the University of California, Berkeley, and a part-time secretary at the French consulate. Born in France, Louise was bilingual. Yet the 18-year-old Louise stretched the truth in a different direction. She and her younger sister, Raimonde, read about the opportunity with the Signal Corps in the student newspaper and immediately wrote the War Department. The photos they mailed showed beautiful young women with tresses done up in Gibson girl style. When the Le Bretons received telegrams in January to come for interviews, Louise told the A&T rep that she was 21. He reported that Louise was a young woman of character beyond reproach and intelligence of a high order who looks and acts older than her age. Raimonde told her interviewer that she was 18, though she was 16. He too was fooled. Her interviewer described her as considerably more mature than age would indicate, and capable of standing up to severe strain, as she is wiry, well-knit, and alert. And both of them passed inspection. The girls were not entirely truthful to their mother either, who did not know they had applied. Jean Le Breton was a struggling single mother of four daughters, two younger than Louise and Raimonde. She ultimately gave her consent with the proviso that Louise and Raimonde be kept together. AT&T agreed, and the Army split them up the second day they were in Paris. The Army and AT&T preferred the recruits to be between 23 and 33 years old. Once Wesson and Estabrook determined how to process applicants, events moved quickly for the first three contingents. To her surprise, Grace was selected to lead the pioneer group. The morning Grace sailed from New York 2 months later, the faces of the team glued to the portholes and doors as the Statue of Liberty drifted from sight. She confided to her diary, for the first time, suddenly I realized what a responsibility I have on my young shoulders. Nonetheless, on January 15th, 1917, she raised her right hand and swore to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. The AEF, American Expeditionary Forces, needed women to run their telecommunications, but only the best would do. In 2 months or less, the pioneers had to be selected, trained, outfitted, and dispatched. Grace Banker's group numbered 33. They left in March. Four other units arrived in Europe by August. Before making the final cut, they were called to one of six training centers. And next came language tests, medical exams, and telephone training. One more hurdle before final processing, intensive instruction in PBS X systems. magneto boards, and common battery exchanges to learn local and long-distance techniques. Approximately 15% flunked this final phase. When called to New York, the women met as military units in Manhattan. There they met their chief operators, got fingerprinted and photographed for passports, heard lectures on hygiene, practiced drilling, and listened to talks by Signal Corps officers. The Army issued them a list of items to purchase, from tan parade gloves, woolen stockings, sateen bloomers, and union suits, to bicarbonate of soda, Lysol, iodine, and sewing kits. Uniform coats, skirts, blouses, hats, high-top shoes, and bronze insignia were the most expensive items. The entire kit cost between $250 and $350. AT&T loaned money to those who could not afford the cost, with regular installments deducted from their salaries. For many, earning only $60 monthly, half a year's salary went into their kit. Operators were told their status was similar to that of officers, so uniforms must be individually fitted. By contrast, yeomanettes received standard-issued suits at no cost. Yet the women loved their uniforms, which meant full membership in the AEF. As the Telephone Review of New York described the Girls in Blue to its readers, every soldier must have a uniform, and the telephone operator units, being part of the Army organization, are no exception to the rule. They also learned military protocol. Operators saluted supervisors and so on up the chain of command. Drills took place atop the AT&T building at 195 Broadway. The operators marched until they were sweaty and then chilled. One girl said, "We are beginning to feel miserable. We're getting colds from overheating and drill on the windy roof." The Signal Corps considered this situation good training for Northern Europe. Each of the six regiments that served in France was photographed in full regalia atop the AT&T building before sailing. They had survived what one called a severe mental and physical test. Next screen. And that's a picture of them getting ready to sail. The day finally came. They marched onto the pier and into one of the immense troop ships that towered above the docks. Grace Banker kept a diary, though it was against regulations. When her regiment sailed, she wrote, 32 girls in my charge, several older than I, youngest 19. After 2 months of preparation in the United States, I've crossed the Rubicon now. There can be no turning back, unquote. Olita Jure,
next picture,
was a Detroit operator who sailed with the 6th Unit. One of 13 children, Olita had not anticipated the lonesomeness she would feel among thousands of strangers as they traveled the sea. She said, "I realized that I would be separated from my family for a long time. At night, I used to go up on deck and crawl underneath a lifeboat to cry out loud," unquote. Illness posed a great risk. Germs turned virulent that fall in the second wave of the 1918-1919 flu pandemic. The Spanish flu had two exceptional characteristics. It hit young people hardest, and it resulted in an unusual bacterial pneumonia that killed swiftly. Spanish influenza nearly overwhelmed the Olympic, on which the 6th Unit sailed. Olita Jure, an accomplished singer and pianist, kept up the men's spirits by playing a piano someone had hauled on deck, and those with enough strength sang along to Irving Berlin's war tunes that she knew by heart. The United States had been in the war nearly a year when the first three units arrived in March and April 1918. Strangely, the operators were not even late. American soldiers were just amassing and had not fought a single battle of their own, of which their bleeding partners were painfully aware. When the first Signal Corps women arrived and boarded a train for Paris, Signal Corps Captain William Vivian told them their destination was under bombardment. The women were undeterred. Bertha Hunt felt inspired by his trust in their commitment and competence. She wrote, "It certainly is flattering to see how proud these Signal Corps officers seem to be of us," she wrote. The first 33 women soldiers received their assignments. One group staying in Paris, another group to Tours, a third heading for General Pershing's headquarters in Chaumont, 150 miles southeast of Paris. Grace Banker and Louise Le Breton counted themselves lucky to be joining Pershing. "We are going to the bombing section," Grace wrote happily. The next day at Chaumont, she said, the girls took their places at the boards, thrilled to connect the Army's lifeline. Soldiers expressed astonishment when they heard the voices of American women and the familiar AT&T greeting so very far from home. In her diary, Grace recorded the reaction of one man in particular. "When you said number, please, I couldn't answer," the soldier told Grace. "There was a lump in my throat." Like other new troops, Signal Corps women faced four initial tasks: master their assignments, develop effective relationships with co-workers, settle into military life, and establish a support system to endure looming challenges. And they had to accomplish these tasks in a setting that reminded them constantly of their mission's urgency. Maimed young men, roadside graves, devastated villages, and short-tempered superiors under horrific strain. Mastering their assignment was both the easiest and the hardest challenge. The results of battles and lives of thousands of our soldiers frequently depend upon the speed and accuracy with which telephone operators complete connections, Merle Egan wrote. Most women became practiced at the job, but found the workload and responsibility daunting. A week after their arrival, the boom of enemy artillery shook windows and walls so badly that, quote, the phones were almost impossible to use at times, unquote. Grace Banker fell into bed, exhausted most nights. She said, I just managed all day until I was all in, unquote. Their dedication, though, paid off. In July 1918, toll calls quintupled. By November 11th, the Signal Corps was averaging 4,000 toll calls and 150,000 local calls every day. By war's end, they had connected more than 26 million calls. Excellent job performance helped the women with their second task, developing good relationships with skeptical men. Lieutenant J.W. Reiser admitted to Grace Banker, quote, he was mad when he first heard he was to have charge of a lot of female operators, unquote. But they converted him within the week. She said, now he's very proud of us all, Grace wrote after taking charge at Chaumont. General Pershing himself reached out to female troops. They saluted him, and he saluted them back. When he made an inspection of their housing, he spoke with each operator upon arrival, shining his starry fame on every individual. And this is a picture of General Pershing with the Hello Girls. Comradeship held them together. At Chaumont, the women hiked 3 miles each way to work, keeping one another company in the early morning and after dark when they struggled along muddy roads. At Ligny and Berois, close to the front, They slept on the same mattresses and fought insects together. Quote, bed bugs with us still, so we were on the hunt a good part of the night, Bertha Hunt wrote. General Pershing took Grace Banker with him when the United States troops finally assembled to move en masse. Pershing planned to establish a First Army headquarters close to St. Mihiel. He took six female operators with him. His plan was to attack St. Mihiel and then go 60 miles north to participate in the Meuse-Argonne offensive 10 days later. The work for the 6th Signal Corps Hello Girls exploded. Preparations for a drive were enormous. For the first time, the women practiced with pistols and gas masks. On a ridge outside the town, they loaded, aimed, and fired. The 6th operators slung steel trench helmets and flexible gas masks on the backs of their chairs. German bombers flew over, and American anti-aircraft guns shooed them away. Next screen. And this is a picture of them doing their job there. In the Battle of Meuse-Argonne, no one knew that this would be the largest, longest, deadliest single battle in all American history, that it would kill more than 26,000 and injure another 95,000 in the course of 47 days. But commanders understood that the fall offensive might decide the war, and in it, America would prove what it could bring to the struggle, and so would the Hello Girls. Throughout the following 46 days, the flimsy wooden walls of the Signal Corps barracks shook. Situated next to a bomb shelter, the billets were their most Spartan accommodations yet. The wooden buildings floated on a sea of mud at Suwilly Army headquarters. The women shoved newspapers and old maps into cracks to keep out the cold. The roof leaked so badly that Grace Banker had to move her cot repeatedly to find a dry spot. The Hello Girls knew the Army counted on them. Their work was important. Finally, in mid-October, the tide of the war turned. Enemy troops did not know the location of the First Army headquarters. Telephone operators had helped to preserve the secret, aware that enemy agents monitored many conversations, trying to deduce just where Pershing was holed up. November 8th, everything was over. Meanwhile, President Wilson back home was under pressure to grant women their suffrage. Daunting complications arose for everyone, including the female soldiers of the United States Signal Corps. The Signal Corps operators remained under army discipline in France. A team was ordered to Koblenz, Germany, to run telephones for the United States Army of Occupation. All 223 female soldiers were still in France for Christmas 1918. Brigadier General Edgar Russell's letter, dated the day after the armistice, acknowledged that skepticism had attended the women's arrival. It pleases me a great deal to say that by your ability, efficiency, devotion to duty, and the irreproachable and businesslike conduct of your affairs, personal and official, you have not only justified the action taken in assembling you, but have set a new standard of excellence that could hardly be improved upon, unquote. Dozens of other officers added their thanks for the women's grit, unfailing courtesy, ready acceptance of hardship and privations, cheery responses to gruff and unreasonable demands. Colonel Parker Hitt told superiors, quote, a large part of the success of the communications of this army is due to a competent staff of women operators, unquote. He said also they had a most uncanny way of finding routes to strange places, and it seemed impossible for them to give up a call after it had once been requested. On May 10, 1919, the U.S. Army notified their chief operator, Grace Banker, that she would receive the highest honor of all. The AEF Commander-in-Chief, in the name of the President, has awarded you the Distinguished Service Medal. And it said, by untiring devotion to her exacting duties under trying conditions, she did much to assure the success of the telephone service during the operations of the First Army against the St. Mihiel Salient and the operations to the north of Verdun. Next screen. And this is a picture of Grace receiving the Distinguished Service Medal. The Signal Corps operators continued their orders until the last ones left in 1920. Female veterans discovered, when they got home to America, that they were not soldiers in the eyes of their government and the world. When they applied for something, whether treatment in an Army hospital, membership in a veterans organization, tax benefits offered, or the bonus granted to every soldier, sailor, Marine, and nurse. Surprise characterized their letters. Whatever they applied for, the Hello Girls received the same baffling answer. They had been contract employees, even though they had not signed contracts. They were not entitled to a single post-war benefit, not even the name veteran. Discharge papers would not be forthcoming, no matter how many times their release was described as a discharge. They had not been soldiers, no matter how many officers had told them, "You're in the Army now." Well, when Merle Egan applied for her Victory Medal, the War Department said she had not been in the Army. But when the Navy granted full benefits to female yeomen, Merle Egan became a leader. Her ensuing fight exposed not only the War Department's resistance to change, but also the remarkable dedication of those men who knew the operators best. Men's loyal advocacy proved critical during the next 60 years. Even more important was the women's initiative. Although some declined to fight their government's harsh judgment, others opposed it with the grit they had shown since the day they first raised their right hands. General George Squire went to bat for the Hello Girls, but Secretary of War Baker denied the request for bonuses. General Squire tried to get the Adjutant General to issue victory medals, also without success. In 1922, he made a third run at veterans' benefits. Once again, the quest got nowhere. An internal report from 1926 considered women, and this is a quote, not only unnecessary, but troublesome to an army, unquote. This pattern persisted for 50 years. At least 24 times between 1927 and 1977, representatives in Congress introduced bills to acknowledge female veterans. The War Department blocked each attempt. During the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s, the Hello Girls contacted some very important people to help them. Robert Taft, LBJ, JFK, Edward Kennedy, Mike Mansfield, Robert McNamara, William Westmoreland, all with the same results. Entering her 80s, Merle Egan could not quite manage to give up. For Merle, the message of old age was not to slow down, but to hurry up. She contacted Chet Huntley. She gave interviews and talked to school children. She found a veteran to donate her uniform to the Signal Corps Museum at Fort Monmouth for a display on World War I. She sent petitions and contacted NOW, the National Organization of Women. And that summer, NOW leader Pat Leeper wrote an editorial for the Washington Times, and a youthful champion stepped forward to help. Mark Huff read the article entitled, quote, 1918 operator still seeks justice after 50 years, unquote. Mark was an attorney with Seattle's oldest law firm, and he contacted Merle Egan, then 87 years old. He asked her, do you need an attorney? He felt their case was strong and they needed an advocate to organize and present their evidence properly. Mark Huff volunteered his time for the next 4 years. Using Merle's contacts, he solicited affidavits and other evidence from former operators. Next screen. This is one of the certification of identity for the War Department. Here's a Signal Corps memo, a memento that one of the girls was given. Here's a telegram and a newspaper article say, hello girls here in real army duds. He helped her collect these all. The long retired women mailed all these mementos that they had saved for 6 decades. Mark Huff wrote to Barry Goldwater, who promised that if the Signal Corps had a strong case, he would add them to legislation he had convinced 18 other senators to endorse. Goldwater had been a pilot in World War II and considered it outrageous to deny recognition to females in the military. In May 1977, Merle Egan Anderson received the notice for which she had waited half her life, an invitation to appear before the Senate Committee on Veterans Affairs. The 87-year-old could not go, but Pat Leeper told the assembly that despite infirmities, the Hello Girls asked me to tell you they are here in spirit, and they had their say at last. Congress passed the bill in November 1977. President Jimmy Carter signed it into law. Dear ladies, wrote Mark Huff, we have won round one. And this is the next screen. This is Mark Huff and Merle Egan Anderson. We have won round one. It would take 2 more years for the Army to process their discharges, but they would eventually receive them. Mark helped 31 survivors apply. Merle Egan Anderson lived to see the day. Grace Banker did not. 300 Hello Girls were gone, yet they were no longer forgotten. Merle addressed the audience at Fort Lawton when she and two other veterans accepted their discharge papers on August 28, 1979. The 91-year-old declared on their behalf, quote, the Army has finally admitted that we are legitimate. And after retelling her story, she added, if I do get a victory medal, it should be for fighting the Army all these years, unquote. Today, the skirt, the blouse, the cap, and gloves with service chevrons and Signal Corps insignia are proudly displayed along with other mementos in Kansas City at the National World War I Museum, where you can see the record of America's first female soldiers. Thank you.
Thank you so very much for presenting that.
You're welcome.
I'll have to get that book. Who's the author of the book?
The author is Elizabeth Cobbs.
Okay, Elizabeth Cobbs, The Hello Girls. I think it's going to be a great read for anybody who's interested in some unknown or little known history of a great group of women who made a tremendous difference in World War I.
Absolutely.
And then fought for their recognition for another 60 years after that.
Right.
Thanks so much for doing this, Hallie.
We
appreciate
welcome.
Your being on our program.
Oh, thank you. Mm-hmm. I enjoyed being here.
Good.